In this extraordinary time that I have warned about, there's something even more extraordinary going on, and that is I'm receiving advice as to how to cope with these times. And this advice suddenly just occurs to me, and I think, why didn't I ever think of that before? That's amazing. It's so simple, so obvious. This is the advice of the Holy Spirit. This is the feeling like you have, like, wow, it's so obvious, and yet I never ever thought of it before. And where did that come from? So I'm going to share that bit of advice with the world in this video. For those who have ears to hear it, it may slip through the cracks. It's so simple, actually, but so incredible. And it may very well be the key to surviving these times, in fact, surviving time itself, actually. There's a couple aspects to it. Now, I'll start out by asking a question. You know, sometimes when you're daydreaming and you have this imagery in your mind, sometimes it's very beautiful, dreamlike imagery, and you know you're still awake, and you say, ah, I want to stay focused on this imagery. And as soon as you do that, it seems like you start to see it, try to see it with your eyes, your sensory eyes, and poof, it fades away, right? And you go, where did it go? Happens to me all the time, and this is something that has tormented me my whole life, because the inner imagery seems to be so perfect and beautiful, and I don't want it to vanish, but I always try to see it with the eyes, and then it's gone. Well, I've got a little, this morning, while that was, something like this was going on, an idea occurred to me, and it said, why don't you try viewing it as temporary? Whatever you're viewing, say, oh, this is temporary. And just have this attitude, okay, this is temporary. And accept and see the temporariness of it. Accept that. Accept it as temporary. Whatever arises in the mind's eye. I said, wow, okay, I'll try that. And what I have found is that it changes. It changes the dynamic of my mind. I don't go to try and grasp it with my eyes. It's like a meditative state, really, if you say, okay, whatever arises, it's temporary. It's just temporary. Then it doesn't, things don't seem to leave, want to leave. It's the desire, I believe, to try to make something permanent, which causes it to vanish for us. So I began to contemplate on this. Why not see it as temporary? And this has become a new foundation stone of how to survive the times, actually. Because what I've found is that what this advice is getting at is to allow a change within us. Allow us to be flooded with this incredible inspirational beauty and purity by having the attitude of saying, staying centered and say, well, come, whatever, let it come. Look, but I know it's only temporary. I know this is only temporary. So I'll just stay centered in this realization that this is just temporary. So the realization that it's temporary comes first. But that somehow opens the door to remaining centered and not getting overwhelmed by anything. For instance, if you had this vision, this incredible vision, and you felt yourself getting lost in it and wanting to be one with it and experience it and possess it and have it for always and stuff, it's going to go, it's going to vanish. But let's say you had the same incredibly beautiful vision of whatever, and you just said, you shrugged your shoulders and said, I'm viewing something that's temporary. Okay, I'm just viewing something that's temporary. Totally different mindset, right? You remain calm, centered, not bothered, and then the vision just remains there, like floating like a bubble. It's like there's a bubble. Let's say there's this beautiful bubble, soap bubble, in floating in front of you, and you say, "Oh my gosh, you're there!" And you reach out for it, and you say, "I want to touch this bubble and hold the bubble." And poof, gone. Whereas if you say there's a bubble floating in front of you, you say, "Well, this bubble is temporary. I'm just looking at something that's temporary." See the beauty of it, but you just say, "Well, it's temporary beauty." Okay, it's temporary beauty. See, and it just remains floating in front of you. So this advice, I found it to be completely brilliant. And it didn't come from me. I said, "Where'd that come from?" I mean, I wasn't even thinking about anything like that at all. It seems counterintuitive, doesn't it? Very counterintuitive. But the counterintuitive, when something really counterintuitive comes up, that is a sign. You should pay attention to that. We're not talking about just some silly whimsicalness. No, it's so amazingly counterintuitive. Look at it. You say, "But I want it to be permanent." But remember that anything we perceive, that the purpose of what the Holy Spirit shows us is to remind us of reality. It's the vision of remembrance. But that's temporary, because eventually we'll drop that too. So the attitude of going, if you have an attitude of, "Yes, this is temporary," even for the very best you can possibly perceive, I believe that opens the door. It opens the door for this vision to come. Because again, you don't want to try to make it permanent. As I've said, the ego wants to make perception permanent. So it will try to grasp this and make it real, make it permanent. Whereas the Holy Spirit knows that we have to set perception down eventually, entirely. So it's only using perception to remind us of reality. Now, in cultures of meditation, I believe that this is part of their understanding and knowledge, where whatever it appears to you, no matter what, they remain and say, "Oh, this is temporary." Those are the meditation masters, actually. And there have been some of those. I think in Tibet has had some of those, a tradition of that. Some of the high traditions around the world have had the knowledge of this somehow. But to see it for yourself, you know, organically in your own life, and saying, "Hey, let me apply this," that's very profound, actually. Because ordinarily we think we want something that's very desirable and wonderful. We want it to be permanent. But I would say, take the opposite approach. Don't tell it to go away. Just say, "I know that this is temporary. I'm viewing temporariness." And you don't really look at it directly. When you have that feeling, it's kind of like it occupies a different perceptual space in your mind. You're not trying to grasp it with your eyes, with your perception. Perception is not trying to grasp it. It's kind of like saying, "Okay, sit down beside me, and we'll just, you know, sit here together. But I know that, you know, that you're temporary. You're temporary, so I'm not going to get too excited about it." So this idea was suggested to me this morning. About 3:30 in the morning, I keep waking up at 3 in the morning every morning. I can't sleep past 3 o'clock in the morning. It's terrible. And I'm getting, you know, worn out. And so I spend then hours and hours and hours trying to, you know, clarify and say, "Hey, there's got to be some answer to the stress in the world, because the fabric is coming undone to, again, not a surprise at all. Not a surprise. This is what has been foreseen. This is the unraveling. And there's more to it than we know, and it's worse than we know. Really is way worse than we realize. And I can get into this a little bit, but I gotta be careful, because there's some sensitive toes in the world, actually, right now. Because the... So, another thing that the Holy Spirit pointed out was, when you see this temporary vision, and you accept it as temporary, it doesn't go away then. It won't go away. It won't leave you. Because you're accepting it as it is instead of trying to change it, right? That's our whole problem. We refuse to accept reality as it is. We want to change it. So when a reminder of reality comes, instead of saying, I want to change you into something real, accept it as it is and say, no, this is temporary. I accept this as temporary. So bliss, you'll say, I accept bliss because, you know, it's temporary. I accept that it's the fact that it's temporary. I accept it as it is. It's temporary. The problem that we have in the world is so deep-rooted that it's hard to even talk about. It is rooted in our desire to be prime creator. That's where it actually comes from. And it can never be solved at the level of effects. Not truly resolved at all. But we can be reminded of reality at the level of effects. Yes, we can. However, trying to solve it, in other words, make it a permanent solution is impossible. It's impossible. So we have all the struggles that go on in the world in so many different ways, and none of those work to resolve it. It doesn't work. We're not looking for a resolution to anything. We're looking for a remembrance of reality. Not a resolution, a remembrance. So one of the most severe problems in this world is the education that we receive, actually. It is such an extreme problem that it is, again, hard to even talk about. What the problem really is with our education is we have got this notion that we're supposed to be exceptional, okay? And parents want to raise exceptional children. And they feel that there's some incredible crime to being normal, okay, non-exceptional. But it's a very deep thing. We're so geared up to saying we need to produce exceptional citizens, exceptional people, exceptional, exceptional, exceptional. What is exceptional? What are we making exception to? See, is the question. What we really need to do at this time right now is to give up the quest to be exceptional, because that's burning us all out. It's burning the country up. And ultimately, this idea of exceptionalism is burning the world up. We don't need to be exceptional. Nobody needs to be exceptional. As a matter of fact, this whole notion of being exceptional is what is making exceptions to what we really are. So when you're really pushed to be exceptional, I remember my own life as a perfect example. I actually am a classic case of this whole situation of exceptionalism. Being born into a situation where my whole life was based, my education and influence was based on trying to be exceptional. From parents to education, everything was that you are an exceptional child, you will be a very exceptional person, and I fought against it because I said, wait a minute, the way I am I am that I am. This, my identity is already set, I know what I am, and you're telling me I'm supposed to be something different than what I am. I had all these qualities, and they said, no, we need to make you exceptional. And I said, I don't want to be exceptional. I want to function the way that I'm functioning right now because it's enlightened. And this is the way I'm supposed to be. And everyone said, no, you need to be better. You need to be exceptional. In other words, exception from what you really are. That's actually our education is based on trying to be different than what we really are. And the stress that entails is horrific. It's a death march, actually. So the problem is that this nation is in the grips of this mania of exceptionalism based on our educational system, based on the so-called expertise of child education experts and child rearing children, etc. And having gone through that entire thing, I can tell you is that they are absolutely lunatics. They don't have a clue what they're doing, really. They're miseducating the children of the world. Very badly miseducating them. because they're ignorant of the fundamental truths. They're ignorant of the Holy Spirit, actually. They're ignorant of how the mind really works, what's really going on in this world. The ignorance is staggering, and yet they claim to be educational experts and be able to raise exceptional people, whatever that is supposed to mean. The same thing happened in Nazi Germany. In fact, our educational system comes from Prussia, which is what brought about Nazi Germany. And there, the people of Germany, the parents, the Fräuleins especially, you know, the idea was we are going to raise a super race. We're going to give birth to and rear the children and educate them, and we're going to create this super race, which is going to be completely exceptional, something that's never been seen in the history of this planet. And that super race is going to be the bureaucratic apparatus to create a one world government. That's what the Nazis were all about, actually. And it came from this ideology, especially talking about children, early education, instilling in them this ideal, this glamorous ideal of exceptionalism, led to disaster. It is the worst thing possible to try to instill in children. What children should be allowed, first of all, their parents should show them that they listen to the Holy Spirit, the advice of the Holy Spirit, and the humble parents saying, of myself, I cannot solve the continuity problem. The problems of the world are not resolvable. That should be the attitude of the parents. And then the child realizes, I don't have to try and do the impossible. And then they can open up to the Holy Spirit. Then they can open up to bliss and recognize it's temporary and accept that, which is a normal thing. In other words, they can be normal, truly normal. To be normal is to be perfect, because we as spirit are perfect. So to be truly normal is to be perfect. Okay, so these great saints and sages and avatars, gurus, whatever, they're actually normal. We're the ones who are abnormal. We've created an abnormal society, an extremely abnormal society. And that is what is running this planet right now. Especially the United States, for example, living here. We can talk about that. There's no question about it. If you really look into what's going on beneath the surface in the U.S., it is this drive for exceptionalism, okay? Developing human potential and spreading that throughout the world, this ideal. It's a misguided ideal, a ruinous ideal, actually. So the whole attitude of children and allowing ourselves to accept what is, and then to accept that it's all temporary, and that to abide in this without trying to resolve the problems of the world, etc., is actually salvation. That doesn't exist in the world, really. It doesn't really exist. Even homeschool parents who say, look, they're still trying to make their children exceptional. Most of them. It is almost rare, the point of non-existent, where the parents actually have this enlightened attitude of the problems of this world cannot be resolved. Absolutely cannot. You cannot resolve problems at the level of effects. It's impossible. Only the cause, changing the cause, that's a divine fact. So if we're ignorant of facts, divine facts, how can we rear children properly? Oh, we cannot. It's an absurdity. So it's really allowing ourselves and children and society, allowing them to say, hey, bliss is available to me. And the attitude is, it's temporary. Yes, it's temporary. I don't need to seize upon it. I don't need to represent it. I don't need to try to make it real. I fully embrace the temporary, the temporal nature of it, the temporariness of it. It's not going to be there forever. So I'm just going to allow it to abide in it, to abide in that. This could be embodied in this world. This attitude could be, and that would change the world for the better, as far as peace goes, and relations between people and cover everything in the world would be amazingly different, actually. And then the world wouldn't really last very long at all from that point on, because people wouldn't need it anymore. They accepted the temporary, impermanent nature of the world, be shown a perception by the Holy Spirit, which reminds them of reality, and then at some point they'd be not worried at all about setting perception, impermanence, form down, all so far away from that, so completely upside down and backwards from that. And the toes of those who are instigating these programs are very sensitive toes, and they really are the power brokers in this world. I tell you the truth. Those people who have these ideals of how people should be educated, especially children, those are the ones who are really holding power and pushing agendas on us. And if I get into it even more, those toes may be stepped upon, and that might not be a good thing to do, because they are very self-righteous. So it just allowed us to sink in a little bit. Little bit. Now, let's bring in one of the most important people in the world, which is the Pope. Now, somebody, I remember in the homily the priest last Sunday said that a reporter just recently asked the Pope, you know, how does he see himself? You know, and the Pope said, I see myself as a sinner. And the priest said, that's really good, that's great, you know. And I said, no, that's not really great. That's not great, because I said, actually, the Pope is a sinner, and he's not repenting from it. The way that a Christian, and not just a Christian, but let's say a Truthian or a Claritan, you know, I call myself a Claritan, meaning someone whose religion is clarity. A Claritan would say that I'm a repentant sinner. I'm a repentant sinner. In other words, I used to be a sinner, but now I'm repenting. I'm changing my ways. I'm not trying to make perception permanent. I'm getting to the point where I can accept the impermanent reminder of reality and let it go at that. Let it be at that. I'm working on that discipline. That's a repentant sinner. That's what religion is supposed to call everyone to be, a repentant sinner. So saying that I'm a sinner is is not it. And he, you know, the Pope is a sinner in that he is teaching social justice as, you know, the key to salvation, works as the key to salvation, when in fact it's grace that's the key to salvation. And that's a sin. That means missing the mark. So he's very much missing the mark and not repenting of that missing of the mark. And that comes from, again, this educational system that people have been raised on, of what? Trying to teach children to be exceptional, thinking that in doing so we can solve the problems of existence, which is totally untrue. It actually makes things worse, way, way worse. We get farther and farther away from the remedy, and we're not willing to listen and hear, like I did early this morning, 3:30 in the morning. One moment, please. So I'm not sure if I can catch the thread of my thought, and the moths are invading now. Maybe they're saying it's time to stop. We have to be repenting, because theology is super important. Salvation is by grace. It is by actually accepting, being willing to accept the impermanence of the solution itself. The reminder is impermanent, and be willing to accept that instead of trying to make it permanent. Okay? This is the whole key to salvation, a pragmatic, practical key. There's something you can actually talk about here and apply to yourself, to your life. It's an incredible breakthrough that was at 3:30 in the morning I was given this morning. An incredible breakthrough. And the problem is people are simply not willing to listen and hear such things. That is the disaster that has happened in this world. The inability to hear the right advice that we need. And the sort of rigid, self-righteous, authoritarian belief that the way that they were educated must be the right way. One other problem we have in the world is that those who have been educated in this way believe in experts. And they feel that they have had a degree bestowed upon them by experts. and they will only listen to experts. They feel that their exceptionalism can only be matched by an expert teacher, expert teaching, etc., etc. So if you're not quote unquote an expert in their eyes, they won't pay any attention to you whatsoever. You have to be credentialed and degreed and be in the right, you know, of all this, you know, accolades, medals, whatever. What you have to qualify as an expert, really. Because they feel, oh, I'm not going to waste my time with anyone who's not an expert. I deserve an expert. And this is what an expert is, somebody who justifies the way I was, my exceptionalism. So that's a big, huge problem, because someone could say the exact truth of what you need, and I believe I have right here, the temporariness of it, is really, it is the key. It is really the practical, practicing key of the attitude that one needs to actually entertain bliss. I feel very strongly about that. That, for instance, the Christ child could come down and sit beside you, and you could just sit there too, and you say, well, I know this is temporary, and I'll just allow myself to feel the presence of this, but I know it's temporary, and I'm not going to try to make it permanent. Okay, you can have that, and then you will literally experience the blessing. It is the key to experiencing being blessed, absolutely. But the exceptional, those who think they're exceptional, they think they have some way to make things permanent, you know, and they want experts, and so they only listen to experts. If they don't see you as an expert, forget it. So, big problem. I thought I could be in this world and just be an ordinary Joe, just like everybody else. I don't like being the expert. I've had experience with that in a past life, and I found it to be very much disliked it. Because your people intrude upon your life so much intrusion upon your life. You don't, you know, it's just you can't just spend time clarifying. It's very difficult. So I said, wow, I don't want to be seen as an expert. The problem is the most people in the world, because of their education, will only listen to someone they think is an expert. So even if you have the truth, they won't listen to it. If Jesus came here, you know, people probably say, well, where's your degree? Are you an expert? I mean, they said, we're not going to listen to you, because who are you? Who are you? I don't care what you're saying. Who are you? In other words, where's your exceptionalism? Where's proof of your exceptionalism? They say, we have ours, we have our degree, but where's your proof of your exceptionalism? And Jesus would say, well, there's no exceptionalism at all in me whatsoever. I just simply have this humble advice to accept the temporariness of even the Holy Spirit's gift to you. And that will bring about then this your capacity to dwell, abide in bliss. And people will just say, well, you know, I don't see you as exceptional, and I am exceptional. I want a real, true expert. And that's a problem, right? That's a problem. Huge problem. Eckhart Tolle is listened to because he was in Oxbridge, you know, he went to one of those Oxbridge schools in England and graduated and was very brilliant there and wrote a best-selling book. And so he's viewed as a academic, you know, as like an expert. The academics, people with college degrees, they feel, yeah, I'm going to see Eckhart Tolle today. Oh, you know, yeah, he's an expert. He fits the mold of being an expert. But someone else could say the same thing and nobody would listen to him, really. Very few. So that's a problem, because I don't have the trappings of being an expert. I don't have any credentials at all. And it's a very real roadblock, I think. Very real. People are so invested in their exceptionalism that they simply cannot bring themselves to listen to somebody who just, you know, has no credentials whatsoever. They feel it would be just an incredible blow to their reputation and their self-esteem and the way they view themselves. They say, I can't do that. I can't. You expect me to go where? Listen to who? What? That's not the Dalai Lama. I'll go see the Dalai Lama, you know, sure. But this person has no credentials at all. You're crazy. I'm not going to listen to them at all. A priori dismissal. But the truth is, in my case, the truth is that I actually flunked my teachers, you know. It wasn't like I was looking for a grade from my teachers. I was actually there evaluating the teachers, grading them. And I gave them a did not pass. I flunked them. And same with school and college. I went to college, but I flunked college out. I mean, I did the flunking of college. I said, you don't pass my standards. You get an F. You get an F. That's how I, you know, how I lived in the world. It is, you know, I'm evaluating the teachers. Are these teachers any good? And I said, no, they're terrible. Is this school any good? It's terrible. And the same thing, I've given, you know, the Ivy League colleges a flunking grade, the Oxbridge colleges a flunking grade, the teachers, they all flunk. Now, that is a fact, they flunk. They're not teaching truth at all. They're not teaching what is truly pragmatic and helpful at all, so they get an F. And that's how I view it. So it doesn't bother me, but other people say, well, where's your credentials? And I say, well, what do you mean? I don't need any credentials. But people say, well, we won't listen then, because it has to enhance our reputation. We went to see someone who was a great expert, and other people go, oh, wow. He went and saw them. Oh, wow, you saw an expert. You're burnishing him. You must be really even more exceptional now. Yep. And the cars and the houses, everything is based on exceptionalism, showing off one's exceptionalism. Yeah. Big problem for people. It's this doggone, you know, the whole ego complex. So, without anyone needing to be exceptional in any way, this key can be practiced about, this is temporary. So even if the vision of Christ Child came in front of you right now, you wouldn't try to stare it down or acquire it with your eyes, okay? You'd say, okay, this is a vision, Christ Child, and this is temporary. You don't dismiss it. You don't say, go away. In fact, you say, well, I'm glad this is here. This is wonderful, but it's also temporary. This is beautiful, wonderful, and it's also temporary. And abide in that. You don't need any degree for doing this. You don't need any exceptionalism for doing this. This is just total, full-on, pragmatic advice that will actually work. And this turns you into a meditation master, actually. If when applied. So the ones that are really blessed are the ones who are willing to hear advice and listen to advice and get advice and apply it, no matter who they are. It doesn't matter who you are, what kind of exceptionalism that you claim. The advice is the same for everyone. And the problem is that those who have this education of exceptionalism believe they have some higher techniques of being able to acquire something. So their approach to some vision like that would be, okay, I should be able to acquire this, you know. And then, gone. And they say, ah, truth is imaginary. It vanishes on me, you know. It's not permanent. I want something permanent. Well, the reminder of reality is not permanent. It's reality that's permanent, but a perceptual reminder cannot be. Perception itself is not permanent. But because of the continuity issue, we need a reminder. So, there's no technique other than to abide in this recognition, okay, this is temporary. And all I want to be is normal. I surrender all my credentials of exceptionalism. Because really, those only get in the way of abiding in this acceptance of the temporariness of it. Because every last bit of education of exceptionalism is telling you there's a way to acquire this. If you want to be exceptional, then you have to believe you can acquire this, you can acquire it. And so every last bit of it causes you to try and pounce on that bubble and get it. Whereas the right approach is to not try and pounce on the bubble. There's a beautiful bubble there. Okay, let the beautiful bubble be there. I know it's temporary, and I don't need anything to acquire anything that's temporary. But if the bubble wants to remain there, fine, that's good. It's beautiful, it reminds me of reality. And that's the attitude. But our teaching that we're completely saturated with leads us in exactly the opposite direction of that. And that's why I have this frustrating inability to just let it be, truly let it be and accept the temporariness of it. We have this incredibly difficulty with that. People try to take drugs to mess up this teaching that they've gotten, you know, because they know it's messing them up bad, and they think that the drugs can like sort of short circuit it. So you don't try to, you know, grab the bubble. They'd be so kind of confused and they forget their teaching. They maybe just let the bubble be or something like that. But the teaching is still there. They haven't really truly undermined the teaching and freed themselves from it. And so they become dependent on drugs, and that leads to a great deal of trouble. So one has to actually clarify, you know, why we're doing this, etc., which I've done in the video. So it's, you know, that is the shortcut. So be a Claritin. Be someone who's into clarifying, is really into it. That's the right education. You're being truly educated then, away from exceptionalism to accepting the impermanent, the temporary impermanent nature of all perception, which then allows the Holy Spirit to give you a perception that reminds you of reality, and then the continuity problem will be resolved for you, and you will be saved from this wretched dream, really, of trying to reconcile mutual exclusives and constantly oscillating. The oscillation between mutual exclusives is time, shifting perceptions constantly and viewpoints. It's, you know, just absolutely terrible dream, actually. Be saved from it. You'd be absolutely saved from it. And that's, ultimately, that's everyone's goal. We just have to hear the advice and heed the advice. That's all. All right. Give it a try. Let it sink in. And maybe at some moment in your life, you'll get the Holy Spirit will give you some advice, and you'll say, this is it. I'm going to try this. Okay? All right. Very great. Everybody hang in there. I'm trying to hang in here. It's very tough right now, actually. Because of the lack of sleep, but we'll see if I can hang on a little longer. Okay, that's it.